Hi, I'm Jean Gabès. I'm the Shinken leader. And first of all, sorry for my English. I know it's a nightmare for you. So we will try to do with it. So let's get back to basics. Why does we monitor IT systems? Because when IT get mad, get down, the business is really impacted. And this is not good for admin jobs. If the boss see this, you're quite fired in the next hour. When IT get really, really wrong, it can be even worse, but it's another story. So let's focus on save the business. So let's look at the monitoring tools. There's lot of them, lot of them. The most important one in the last 10 years is still Nagios. Is the number one thanks to several models. And it's a huge modularity, like more German and life status, track, the whole Nagios sphere. So plugins and modularity were very, very important. They were great ideas. It's main power. But maybe now, even with this, there are still new monitoring problems that he can't face. Let's look at the IT were going more and more systems, more and more switch servers, applications, whatever. Each time we got problems, we add a new layers. So we got the physical, the network, the virtual system, the OS, the applications, the load balancer, lot of things. Now it's not acceptable to get an application that is down. So we are always putting clusters everywhere. So it's getting more and more monitoring problems. And of course, we are in a big world. So we got lots of installations everywhere. This gives us a lot of monitoring points and lot of data, so lot of problems for getting just the data we want. So the classic monitoring difficulties are there is just too much points to check. So this is just a matter of load problems. The configurations is getting bigger and bigger, and this is not good at all. Things to manage, like if you've got servers in China, there are maybe you can lost one packet for each 10 packets, so it can be difficult to manage. And of course, your monitoring system should be in a high availability mode. So if you think about a perfect monitoring systems, you want one configuration place that is cut and dispatches into monitoring resources that is checking host servers, applications, whatever. You just want some alerts, just few that are important, and you want to see your data for one place to easily access them. If you need more resources, you ask your boss to buy new servers or thing like that. You add them, you restart, and it's done. Still one configurations, just smart alerts and one place for your data. That's the perfect architecture. So you can try to get this with Nagios, with several modules, scripts, and tools. Or you can just use Shinken. So, what is Shinken? Shinken is start like a proof of concept for boosting Nagios performances, and it starts in Python. And now, in fact, it's a full Nagios rewrite in Python with even more monitoring capabilities that we will see. This is not a one-man show. It starts 3 years now. We can show that the number of contributors per month is similar to the Isinga ones. So it's getting more and more popular, and more jobs to manage contributors too. In France, we also got a dedicated Linux Mag issue. So if you know the French language, you can read it. Sorry, not in German from now. So if we Shinken start like Nagios did with huge performance and distributed architecture that allow to add RAID-like high availability, you've got spare daemons that take the load if one other is dead. You've got multi-levels for load balancing. You can easily manage your DMZ. If you want to add resources in a LAN, or if you want to add resources between data centers, you can manage all these levels of load balancing. It's also multi-platforms. It not just means Unix, this is easy, but also Windows and even Android. In fact, on Android, it's not just a gadget. It's a very good place to send SMS. So you've got two small phones, and you've got a SMS platform with high availability for nearly nothing. So the Shinken speed for load is quite good, similar to Mod German. And it also got in-core business rules to make I need at least X server for this to work. This was in the last year presentation. So if you need more details on these points, please refer to the last year's slide. Now we will, because, so this was problems for the guys that is installing the monitoring systems. But if we look at the users, the administrators, they got lot of problems now due to the number of new layers, new systems to manage. There are some easy things from Nagios. The escalations are really easy to set up now. You can easily putting recurring downtimes or make link between services far more easily, but it's not very, very important. This is important. Nowadays, you've got virtualization nearly everywhere. So, and VMware is the biggest one. You will have 30, maybe more, VM on one physical host. And if this host crash, you don't want to receive a lot of notifications. You just want one. The ESX is down, please repair it. That's all. You want the root problems, what to solve. You don't want a lot of notification. You just want the one that will help you to solve the problems. So, how to manage this? You can say, okay, let's use host dependencies between my virtual machines and my physical host. So the notification logic will manage, the ESX is down. I won't notify for the host, for the down virtual machines. That's good. But there is a small problem. VMware admins. They're moving virtual machine between physical host nearly every day, always. So you can forget to define these relations in flat files, because you don't want each time an administrator move a virtual machine to touch your monitoring configurations. It will be a nightmare to manage, and after 1 week, you will forget to update this. So in Shinken, there is a VMware modules, thanks to the checkexis3.pl plugins. Thanks to OP5 guys for this huge plugins. So in fact, the Shinken will ask to the vCenter's server, give me the links between the virtual machines and the host servers. And it will automatically create the host dependencies. And if an administrator moves a virtual machine to another ESX host, he will pull again the vCenter and show that, oh, this virtual machine was moved. So he will update the host dependency links in Shinken without rebooting. So it's fully automatic. The administrator don't have to manage this. So you don't have flat files. It works like a charm. That was one problem for the administrators. But there is still one big point that is hard to solve. Quite, not coffee beverage. False alerts. Like the ESX problems, you don't want a lot of notifications. You only want the ones that are useful. And this is a quite difficult task. Let's take an example. You've got production environments, and you've got testing environments. Is a critical alert on a testing environment so critical? Did you ever run on the monitor, the server rooms after a critical alarms on a testing environment? I never did. So, how to manage this? Let's ask administrator how they are seeing this. For them, testing is not important. Is not important. Production is important. That's why they are paid. Rule number two, same, still only the productions. That's all that matters. So you can say, okay, let's use notifications parameters for the. Let's take an example. You've got a database service for your testing environment. You disable notifications. Problem solved. One problem, it works for systems, but for network, don't work well. You can have the same switch for the production environment and testing environment. Then you can't just disable the alerts because it's still production and testing. You also got some other problems. An admin don't want to be awake during the night for testing environment. For production, yes. For testing, no. Or you will be really, really mad. So you need to have a root problem analysis to find the root problems and the impacts, and to know, are the impacts really important or not? Are they testing or productions? In Shinken, you can say, my end user applications is testing, is production, is development. You don't have to say my host, my switch is production testing. Doesn't matter. Shinken knows that with dependency that this router is linked with this host, with these applications. So it will be able to see, oh, the router is down. What does it impact? It impacts the servers and these qualifications applications. Is it important? No. It will block the notifications. No, the same router, the same server, but another applications, this time for productions. the notifications will be allowed. And so the administrator will have a short night. So the key idea is to not tag, you don't tag your IT environments. IT is not important. Your end user applications are important. Shinken will manage the, will compute dynamically the root problem importance by looking at what it impacts. So you only have to tag some end user applications, there are quite few, and not your whole IT environment. Far less configurations. So for the testing and productions, there are some side problems. For example, your paid service is maybe important 3 days a month, the day before the pay, the day when you are paid, and the day after. On the other day of the month, it's not important. It can crash, you can do whatever you want. The important is that during 3 days, it should be up. So you want to get the notification during these times, the night, for example, not during the others. So in fact, you can, there was objects in Shinken to manage this, is business impact modulations. You can, a business impact is the value you put on the end user applications to say it's testing or it's productions. It comes from the zero value, that means I don't care at all, three, that's the default value, that means it's standard productions, to five, that means if it's done, I get fired. So, in fact, you are creating a modulations that will put to the five value one service during the paid period. You define a period for 3 days a month. And you link it to the to your end users' services. That is, for example, a business rule between I need my database and my HTTP servers, that is your end user applications. By default, it's free, classic productions. But during 3 days a month, it will get at five, because you link the modulations to these items. So you can modulate time-based modulations your end users applications to really get only the notifications you want on the time you want. So we saw that the root problem analysis is really the core of the Shinken logic. It's very, very important. Like the importance, warning, okay warning, critical, three states, that's just not enough now. We need something more than the business impact level. Okay, that solve the notifications problem for the admins, but they also want to see these informations on their UIs. So Shinken got its own web interface for really focuses on these things. So there is like in the core, a strong separation between root problems and impacts. Admins just want to see the root problems, like the notifications. Both want to see the impacts. They want to see, are my end user applications available that are impacts. The admin want to see, my switch is down, it's important because it broke an end user application, an important end user applications. So it's like the whole it's in the Shinken architecture, so it's high availability by design and without it don't need a database too. So it's very visuals. You will see your dependency trees and things like that. You can use PNP or graphite graphs, and it's meant to be simple to read. So this is the differences between the boss and the admin. Boss focus on possible end users impacts, and admins want to see the root problems. So in fact, for two main user types, there are two main views. Boss get their views, admin got their ones. No one want to see both impacts and root problems. And of course, all is sorted by the business impact. You don't want to see on the top of your UE testing problems if your qualifications problem is put on the second page. No, you want your predictions on the top, flashing. Let's take an example. An admin was quite funny. He got two buildings. In one building, it put the web servers, and the other one, the database for an important services that is defined need and the web servers and the database. But of course, one day, the a switch of the second buildings dead, crash, no luck. So what will the boss will see with Shinken GUI? He will see its important end users services. He will see, oh, not good. he will try to see the dependency tree and see, oh, the root problem is here. It's the switch. So he will know that he got to see the network administrators and ask him to solve it. And what will the administrator will see? He won't see lot of words. He will see one line, just the line that is useful for him to solve the problems. That's the problems. The switch is dead. But it's important. And why is it important? Because if you expand the little arrow, you will see, oh, it breaks the important services. That's why it's important. And that's why his boss will be here in a few moments. The boss and admins can share some views when you see your dependency trees. You can see, for example, it's very tiny. That's your end users applications, and that's your switch. And it's in picture, it don't really flash, but in fact, it's running, it's flashing, you can't miss it. So the boss and the admin can share a view to see the links between the problems. And there is a dashboard when you can just select widgets for what you want. The boss can see its main applications. The admin can see some special parts. You can, it's a widget system. You can test it, even if the demo server is not really reachable from this Wi-Fi, quite a nightmare. If you got another graph system that PNP or Graphite, it's quite easy to add a new one. It's very, very modular. Okay, that solve the I want to see only what I want to see. That's good. But there is still one huge things that you need to do is to put your host and services into the tools. And this is a huge, huge task. So let's get back to the Nagios part. Templates were just great. It solved a lot of configurations. You can create a template for all your Linux, all your Windows, etc., etc. It solved a lot of configurations lines. But even with all the Nagios capabilities for the configuration was still bigger and bigger and bigger. So we tried to solve this by extending the Nagios configuration logic, like with new elements, like the business modulations, and a new feature for a template, for example. Let's take an example. In Negios, you are linking service on groups. That's great. But why put your host in a Linux host group if you already put the Linux tags? It duplicates the Linux informations. Why not say my service will apply on the Linux template? It will save you one group and maybe a lot of them. It can also be useful to define some I want my services to be applied on Linux template machines that are also in the production templates. So you can easily define very specific service for your environment. You define Linux and production in your hostname service definitions, and it will apply on hosts that are both Linux and productions template. And why use templates instead of groups? Because when you've got several properties, you've got Linux, you've got production, you've got web servers, all these things can be used for one service. And if you want to link services to groups, you have to create some link groups between these properties. So for Linux and production, you will have to define a Linux production services to link your service. But if you are using the Linux and host group definitions, you only need to have Linux productions templates. That's all. That's for two properties. If you got 10, you will have 10 lines, and here you will have a lot, very a lot, 100. So less, you only need to tag your host. It's a Linux, it's a production, it's something like this, and then you can apply service to really complex expressions. It's a I want Linux and production, but not on this on a special LAN or something like this. You don't have to define a lot of groups. If you want to reduce your configurations, you can't avoid to have a NOST definition for a NOST. So if you want to reduce the configuration size, you got to play with the services. You got to reduce their numbers. So services are sometimes used and set up with host data. Let's take an example. Oh, the information, which disk does I need to check? It's not a service data, it's a host data. It's one other host will have another disk. Why put the data on the service that you will have to duplicate for another host because there is another disk, when you can put this data on the host? Is the same for database or ports. Put the data on the elements where it's linked. It's linked with host, it's not linked with services. We will see with the disk example. We will, in Shinken, you have a way to say, oh, I need a service for each host data. Let's take the example for the disk. Okay, so you have your Linux servers. You say you add your custom macro disk, I've got slash, var, and data. And you want one services for slash, one services for data, one services for var. You don't have to define three services. you only need to define one that will apply on all Linux hosts and will create one service for each disk property. So it will look at this property, will create the disk slash service, it will create the disk slash var service and slash data service. And now if you got a new Linux server with other disk, it's got slash U01 for Oracle database or whatever, you don't have to duplicate your service. It will also apply to this. It will just create new services. So you only got one element by host, but only one services for all your hosts. It will reduce a lot your configurations, and you don't lost the flexibility. You still have one service for each disk. You don't have to create some slash host group, slash var host group, or something like this. You just define your host, and that's all. Your job is done. It can also be used for network administrators. They say, I want to check for each port. So they got one services for all their switch, all the ports. They say, OK, my switch, it's a big stack of six switch, each one with lot of ports. And with these definitions, Shinken will look at this property and will create a lot of services for just one host. If you got another host, one host definitions and lot of services automatically created. Your configuration is very, very small, but still very powerful. You don't have to create lot of service definitions. So it's very, very easy to manage. If you got a new stack, you just increase the number, you restart, it's done. You just describe your host, that's all. You don't manage anymore your services. So why are we doing this? Because we are in IT, and in IT we are lazy. And I mean a very good IT guys. So what does admin don't want? They don't want to write check plugin from Swatch, so they are getting plugin for monitoring a change. They don't want to manually tag their host. They don't want to say it's a Linux, it's production, it's boring, it's for each host, it's they don't even want to write new configurations files for new systems or something like that. So an admin don't want to manually tag its host, but it still need to be done. So you can say, oh, maybe if a tool can say to me it's a Linux and it's in production, I will apply the Linux and production tag. That's all. Then you can, well, that's the IP range based modules, for example, for the that can be used for this. The Shinken, when it's loaded, it will look at the hostname and address and will try to do an NS lookup of the address and will try to match IP range. And for each IP range, it will apply a property that can be used for, if you got an IP range for your DMZ, it will put on the host, okay, this host needs to be checked from the DMZ dedicated pooler. If you got a specific LAN for your testing servers, okay, for this one, don't apply notifications. And if you are behind a router, just add the router as the parents, so you don't even have to create your network architecture. It will be fully automatic. For example, if you know that your distant LAN is behind a router, for each host that match this IP range, you will add the parent properties with these footers. That's all. You don't have to configure your numerous host on the distance site. It will be fully automatic. So you, with this, you can't forget to configure one host or another. It will automatic. You won't forget anything. So it will tag host, but we still need to add them. So it's still work. So there is the Shinken discovery modules for this. The like in the Nagios philosophy, it's very, very modular. You've got scripts that can output data, and you will apply rules to this data. Let's take an example. Here is a sample script based on Nmap that will scan an host or an IP range, and for each IP will output Nmap data. It will say, okay, this host is a Linux, and it got a lot of open ports, and it's an HP servers. So this script just output this. That's all. It's just doing this. It can output whatever it wants. Doesn't matter. It's just a key value output. Then in your configurations, you can define, okay, I create a rule named Linux. Is if my script say the OS is Linux, I will add on the template list Linux. That's all. Your tag will be automatically tag Linux. Then you can have another rules that we also apply. If the HTTPS port is open, apply the HTTPS template. So you will just discover one host, and you will have in your configurations automatic tags applied and templates for your host. So you came from a manually tag definitions to a rule-based one. It's far more easier to manage. You can rescan your IP range, and you got new tags. So you just have to manage the rules and not your huge number of hosts. This can be useful for simple things, that the SSH port is open, the HTTPS port, it's a Linux, something like this. But for example, for the disk example, you also want to see, I want to get on the disk properties the disk volumes. You can't ask Nmap to do this. So in fact, there is the multi-level discovery. Zabbix tell it's low-level discovery. I say it's multi-level, whatever. So we saw that we use a script based on Nmap to scan the host. This is always launched. It will output data, you will add your first tags. Then in fact, you can look at your current data, and maybe you want additional informations, like give me the disk volumes, give me the Windows share, or something like this. And you will have, you will be able to say, if it's a Windows host, launch this script that will output you new data. And you will loop until you can't get any new data on the host. So you will be able to fully describe your host based on the discovery things. For example, you can say, I want my scripts that give me the Windows shares, it don't need to be run on Linux host base. I only want it to be run if the OS is Windows from the Nmap output. You run, and your host will be tagged Windows by the Nmap base rules. The new script will be launched, and it will output, okay, I know it's a Windows, so I will look at shares and output them. So you can have a full descriptions of your host just with the discovery. You just have to get away from your shell command to get the data, like with a check, but for the configurations. And you just manage vrules, not your whole host numbers. It's quite easy to launch in CLI. You can output disk or output this on a database. Or you can use the new configuration UI. It's still in beta, but it's quite good. It's an interface for these discovery-based configurations. So in fact, you will say, oh, I want to discover, or we scan some host. I click scan. It will launch the discovery process that will try to get data for the host. And we'll say, okay, I found for the Oracle server, it's an Oracle server, it's a Linux, it got SSH, and for my mail servers, it's a Windows 2008 with HTTP, HTTPS, lot of things. And localhost, this was MySQL, Linux, HTTP, etc., etc. You just have to validate, your job is done. It automatically fills the disk, the window share, on whatever you want. If you still want, if you still got some properties that you can't discover by a script, you can go edit the host. So you can order the templates or add special contacts or things like that. You can also manually edit your host macros, because disk shares are host macros, so you can modify them here. So it's not finished, but it's quite advanced. So let's get back from the configuration part, and let's look at a new things in the Nagios world. Check plugins were very, very great. It can help you for a lot of cases. But sometimes you don't have the choice to just listen data and then try to manage it. For example, with CollectD Diamonds, he will say to you, oh, my CPU is 10%. It don't say if it's good or not. It just say 10%. Oh, not easy to manage. CollectD just output the raw perf data, but don't say if it is good or not. So a solution can be to get internal checks that will listen to data and create a check plugins, but in the core, that will listen data and say, oh, this data, it's good or not. And we'll update state, it's okay, warning, critical, with some perf data. In fact, it's like if you are writing checks, but it's in Python, and it will be evaluated into the core. And they got access to data, but also to the whole Shinken things. For example, for the CollectD, output you, oh, I've got 10 users connected on my host. Okay, you will create a triggers files. That's Python. That gets, okay, this trigger will be applied on your service that received your CollectD data. It will say, okay, give me the users' data from CollectD. It will get from the host the warning and critical values, and will just checks like classic checks and say, oh, it's good or not, and will put the okay warning critical value on the service element. It's like a check, but it's internal. It's a bit like how Zabbix is working. So it's maybe not very useful for this case, because it will always be easier to get an NRPE with a check disk or check users. but it can be useful for other things like log parsing. You listen to logs and you got a module that will say if the log is good or not. That can be good. Or for SNAP trap, you listen to traps, to raw traps, and you can create a check that will say, oh, if the OID number is this one, go in critical mode. So you can create checks on passive data. That can also be used for advanced things, like if you want to compute key point indicators values, or if you want to do advanced correlations that can be managed with simple AND or words. Let's take an example for the key point indicators. You got N services with check HTTP. Each one will say, okay, the server answer in 10 milliseconds, 11, 12, whatever. You want a new service that will output you the average value, the average response time value. And you want this to be automatically updated each time you've got a new check HTTP returns. So you just create a three-line triggers that will say, give me the time, perf data time value from all your web servers. I compute the average time, and I set this service value. This service value is it like it was run with an external checks with the output and the perf data. So it will be put in PNP or something like this. You will be automatically compute your average time on another services. You can create the rule you want, if you want the maximum, minimum, whatever. You can do whatever you want with it. So it's very good for computing key point indicators things. It can also be used for advanced correlations. If AND or rules are not possible, like for example, you want to say, I want my Oracle service to be up and the web server average time to be under 5 milliseconds. It's quite hard to do with a simple check. So you will say, okay, I create a trigger. It gets the database state. It will get the average time from your previous services and will code the check and output. That's all. You create a complex rules in the core. So it's very useful for very advanced correlations rules. So, Shinken got a lot of things. So if you want to give a try, just launch this and you will get Shinken with the web interface, PNP, and lot of modules. So one lines and you're done. So to conclude, the Shinken architecture, distributed architecture, is load balanced, high availability, scalable. It's very very powerful. But pure technique things like this are not the only things that nowadays admin wants. They want new things in the monitoring logic. So we are trying to give them some great things like filtering capabilities, automatic tagging, things like this. So the web interface is quite great. The configuration interface should be okay for the next release in a few months. And there will be soon professional support from Shinken Enterprise. So thanks a lot, and if you got questions, just ask.